His wonderfulness this morning. Amen. We do have one problem. We don't have a drummer. So we need you guys to be our drummer, okay? So we need more than three of you to clap, though, because we can't hear three people clapping, okay? All right.
From the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. In the heavenly sound.
Yes.
Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, none were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none ring truer than this.
Come on, God's children.
It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard.
Sing that line again, Sharon.
All the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard.
Everyone sing it with her, and all the powers of darkness.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard.
They have to flee under the name of Jesus.
'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns.
And all the powers of darkness,
and all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard.
Come on, he's gotta flee in Jesus' name.
And all the powers
tremble at what
just heard.
Sing it again.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard.
Come on, they can't drown out a single word.
'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory,
every
glory,
time, every tongue, every nation.
Children singing glory,
every
glory,
tribe, every tongue, every nation.
He reigns.
Hallelujah.
He reigns.
Hallelujah.
Children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah. He reigns.
He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah. He reigns.
Come on, let's pray.
Amen. God is good, amen. You know, the last couple of weeks I've talked about being contagious and what kind of legacy are you leaving behind. And, you know, when you're on the job, we're all contagious in one way or another. Are you contagious with love and peace, or are you contagious with death and disease and disparity? What are you leaving? What are you teaching? I had the opportunity this week to see my brother-in-law. Tuesday afternoon, he called and told everybody bye. He said, I love you, and I'm done. He said, I'm tired of fighting. You know, 2 Timothy, Paul says, I've fought the fight, and I've won the race, and it's time for my departure. Sometimes God ain't ready for that departure yet, amen? We went in there Wednesday night. If any of you have ever watched someone die, they normally have what they call a death rattle. It is probably one of the worst noises that you will ever hear. Unfortunately, that's why they call it the death rattle. We went in there last night, and he was breathing normal. Went in there last night, and he asked for ice chips. Not only did he have them put in his mouth, but we watched him chew them up. I watched my nephew get in his father's face, and he said, Daddy, I don't want you to die. I want you with me. But if you're ready to go, I want you to know it's okay. But if you want to fight, you let me know. And he took his left hand, and he raised his hand up. So last night, they agreed to start putting food back in his feeding tube. My nephew came back to me. He said, Uncle Tripp, I'm afraid it could be the calm before the storm. Again, if you've dealt with death anyway, I've seen people lying in comas, and they wake up, they act normal for about a day, and then they go to be with the Lord. So we never know when our time of departure is at hand. We never know what legacy that we're leaving behind. But when they put the tube in his throat a few months ago, and it was against his will because he had a DNR, so they were not to intubate him. And he told the doctor, take it out. The doctor said, if I take it out, you will die. He went like this, and he went like this. They said, if you leave it in, you can live. He went, no. He had won his fight. He had ran his race. But I'm not convinced that his race is over, amen? Because Tuesday night, they said he wouldn't make it through tonight. Last night, he was starting to fight again. They started singing songs to him. They started reading scriptures to him. And everything just started coming to peace on him. I want to share this morning out of Psalm 68, starting at verse 4. It says, sing to God, sing praises to his name. It said, exalt him who rides on the clouds by his name Yah, and rejoice before him. It says, he is a father of the fatherless. He is a defender of the widows. He is God in his holy habitation. God sits the solidarity in families. He brings out those who are bound into poverty. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land. Pastor Danny Dewey used to say every morning he would get up and he would look in the sky and he would say, Lord, is today the day? Are you standing behind the cloud ready to call your children home? Every day he calls somebody home. The Bible says to be absent from the bodies and present with the Lord. And it says that one day we will all go by the grave. But what do we leave behind? We don't just go away and never heard of anymore. But what do you leave behind on your job, on your home, and your families? If you have a need this morning, there'll be prayer teams that's wanting to pray with you to help you if you have a need this morning. If you just want to come kneel and pray by yourself, the altar's always open. But we serve a loving God this morning, amen? We serve a merciful God. He's only there waiting for us to seek him, waiting for us to ask for him. Father, we give you praise and glory this morning. We give you thanks for all that you do in our lives. Father, we thank you for each and every breath that you give us. God, we're excited for what you're doing in our lives, in our church. Be with our pastors. He brings forth the word this morning. But Father, open our eyes and our ears that we can hear and see and receive what you have for us this morning. Father God, that all we do bring you glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. And amen.
He turned water into wine. And he opened the eyes of the blind. Because he is greater and he is stronger and his ways are higher than any other ways. Amen. If he is for us and he is on our side, then it doesn't matter what comes against us, what trial we face, when people hurt us, it doesn't matter because he is for us. So no one else can be against us. So our prayer this morning is, God, increase our faith as we have others coming against us. We have trials coming against us on a regular basis, Father God. Help us to stand strong and to stand firm in our faith that we have, God. Help us to grow in you through the trials that we face, Father God, because you are stronger and you are greater. Have your way, God. Come on, put your hands together with us.
Water you turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you.
Come on, sing it out.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
yeah. Come on, let's sing that second verse again. Into the darkness he shines.
Into the darkness you shine.
Out of the ashes we rise.
Out of the ashes we
There's
rise.
There's none like you.
There's no one like you. None like
Come on, do
you.
It again. Into the darkness.
Into the darkness you shine.
Hallelujah.
Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you.
Come on, he's greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God
is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
yeah. Hallelujah. Come on, and if our God is for us,
and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us,
sing it again.
Then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Hallelujah!
Then what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God.
And if our God is for us,
then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against?
Like this.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand
against? Sing it again.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
What could stand against?
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
sing it again.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
And if our God,
and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what
do you believe that?
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Nothing and no one.
Then what could stand against?
Come on, sing it out.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
sing it personal. My God,
my God is greater, my God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. My God is healer, awesome in power. My God,
if you really believe that today, that he is stronger, that he is greater, that he is powerful, give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
God, you are greater, you are higher. Lord, increase our faith today, Father. Increase our faith today, Lord, in you. Lord, we've declared to you who you are. Lord, you know who you are, but we've declared it today. We've declared it to ourselves. Now rise our faith, Father, as we wait upon the Lord.
Expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting here for you.
Sing it again, Sharon. If faith can move the mountains.
If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We've come with expectation. Waiting here for you. Waiting here for you.
You're the Lord of all creation, and still you know my heart. The author of salvation, you've loved me from the
our hands lifted high.
To the hill from where our help comes from. Our help comes from you. You are the maker of heaven and earth, and we look to you. There's none like you. There's none beside you. And Father, today I know that there are multiple needs represented right here in this house. But as a body, we lift up to you today our nation, our country. Lord, those that are in leadership today in our country, we ask you, Lord, that you would grant to your people in this country, in this nation, a divine intervention. Lord, a lot of times we just don't know everything that's going on, and stuff swarms out of control sometimes, and we find out at the last minute. But I know that you're sovereign, and I know, God, that you're able to move in this nation. I know you're able to move in this country, in our state, in our own communities. And so we look to you. We pray, God, that you would begin to cause your people to stand up, to rise up, and to be the people of God in love and in true representation of who you are. Enable us and equip us with that power to be that presence in the earth today. Father, we pray for every family that's experiencing loss today. We pray, God, that you would touch Vince and Kathleen Grella as they continue to make this journey with their moms. Pray, God, that you would strengthen them and undergird them, touching them, God, and bringing them even further than they are today. We lift Barney to you, God, today, that you would touch him. Lord, we know that whether it's in hospice care or a hospital or wherever it is, you are still God above any circumstance. We pray, God, that you would touch him and their family. Pray, God, for Doug Moore's dad today, Lord, that you would touch him and minister to him as he makes his final moments of transition on this earth. Be with the family and undergird them with your strength. You know the needs of every person standing in this room today. And I pray, God, that if it's healing, you would be a healer. If it's peace, you'd be a peace giver. If it's provision, you would help provide. But look upon us today, and we'll give you the glory and the honor and the praise, because you've never left us alone. You are always mindful of your children. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Listen, here's what I'd like for you to do before you're seated. I'd like for you to find two or three people that are not seated on your row that did not ride with you. And here's what I want you to do. Slap them a high five, shake their hand, look at them and right square in the eyes and let them know you're not alone. All right, come on, find a couple people. Greet somebody, let them know you're not alone. Just come see me at some point in time. All right, 1 Peter chapter 5 is where we're going this morning. We're going to take a little bit of a journey this morning, and I've got a couple of questions right up front that might make you squirm a little bit, might make you a little bit uncomfortable, but it's going to be all right. Look at your neighbor and tell them it's going to be all right, okay? And as you're turning there, one of the things that's been advertised this week, just to, as an FYI, Tuesday night at 6, starting at 7, but if you go, I encourage you to be there by about 6:30. They're having the first candidates forum for the Isle of Wight County. Most everybody in here knows I'm running for the Board of Supervisors. We don't talk about it a whole lot from the pulpit, but there's going to be a candidates forum that if you would like to go, all the candidates that are running for office in this community are going to be at this forum. It's Tuesday night at Calvary Baptist down the street from Smithville High School. If you'd like to be there, that would be great. If not, keep us in your prayer for that. 1 Peter chapter 5, we're continuing our series today on living under the influence, okay? Not driving under the influence, living under the influence, and we're going to be talking about living under the influence of forgiveness today, all right? Look up on the screen. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that in he shall exalt you in due what? Time. Next slide. Casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Next slide. There you go. Be sober. Look at your neighbor and say, be sober. Some of you need to hear that. No, I'm just joking. Say it again. Be sober. Then he says, be vigilant. And the word vigilant just means be watchful. So be sober, be watchful, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Father, would you add your blessing to your word today? Let it be life and liberty to all of us that hear it. Help us to understand what it means to live under the influence of forgiveness. Help us to change our lenses that you would be glorified by our life and through our life. In Jesus' name, amen. I know you guys pray a lot, yes, because we depend on God, you know. That's what we're supposed to do. First question, you ready? How many of you have ever been drunk? All right, put your hand down. How many of you have ever been inebriated by some type of substance, whether unprescribed or prescribed? Okay? So we understand what it means to not be sober, right? I think we can. We don't have to spend a whole lot of time on saying, you know, what is sober, what is not sober. But for the sake of just a working definition, if you were to define the word sober today, you would find that it literally means not just to not be drunk, but it means to not be impaired by anything that would cause a distortion in your perception. To not be affected or infected or polluted by anything that would alter the way that you see things in life. There are a lot of things that alter our perception. First Peter, he's writing, he says, be sober. In other words, don't let anything jack up your perception in this life, because if it does, you can end up in trouble. And then he tags it on. He says, because the devil, he's like a roaring lion seeking those that he may devour. And the comparison here is pretty tremendous, that he's saying, if you're not sober and you're not watchful in this life, then the enemy will get you. Now, that's really kind of the summation of that. If you're not sober and if you're not mindful and if you're not watchful, then the enemy will get you. How many of you have ever told a lie? How many of you have ever lied to yourself? Okay? Been there, done that. Some of you know the story. When I was 514 pounds, I told myself, that's just the way God made you. Look at myself, yeah, that's just the way God made you. You know, just get all tore up about it and convince myself. But sometimes sobriety in our life and in our mind is right thinking. And that spills over into this area of forgiveness. How many of you have ever wrestled with forgiveness? If you have breath in your body, everybody struggles with it at some point in time in life. But forgiveness or unforgiveness is one of the largest areas that the enemy uses to destroy homes, relationships, communities, the workplace, siblings, families, on and on and on. This thing called unforgiveness actually inebriates your senses and causes you not to think properly. When we get hurt, there's this defense mechanism on the inside of us that says, protect, protect, protect. If, how many of you have ever gotten up in the middle of the night and stubbed your toe? I'm going to tell you what, that is one of the worst pains on this earth. And it's almost like it's a delayed pain. You kick the side of the bed, and it's like that split second, you're like, oh, you know, it's just delayed. It's a horrible pain. But what's the first thing you do? I should have thought before I asked that one. You know, so everybody's probably going to have a different answer. So, I scream when I stub my toe. Some of you might grab your toe. You might hop around. But the point is, everybody does something initially when you get hurt, and that's to grab the area that has been harmed. The enemy is very slick in today's time, in today's culture. How many of you can build stuff? Anybody can build like birdhouses and stuff like that? I can't. I have a hard time. You draw a straight line on a piece of wood, I will guarantee you I will cut it crooked. I am not good with those kinds of things. That is not my craft. It is not my trade. But I could venture to say that if I were doing something for, 6,000 plus years, I would venture to say that I'd be pretty good at it. Okay? And I'd venture to say, if you did what you do for 6,000 plus years, you'd probably get very good at doing it. You say, well, what does that mean? Glad you asked. Satan has been deceiving and destroying people for over 6,000 years. I think he's gotten pretty good at doing it. And no matter how old we are, how much wisdom we think we have, we are still no match. Now, I know everybody tells you, you know, speak this stuff and be positive. Listen, the truth of it is, you in and of your own strength are no match for the enemy. That is why we need a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ and the infusion of his presence and power, and we'll talk about that today. Otherwise, unforgiveness leads to bitterness, and it robs you of your life, and when you wake up finally, it's usually at the end having regrets because you didn't get it out sooner. I've had the honor and opportunity of being at the bedside of hundreds of people that have passed from this life and gone into eternity, and most of the time you hear things that they regretted. They wished they would have done certain things. They wish they wouldn't have done certain things. Is forgiveness a mental act, do you think? Do you think forgiveness would be something that we wrestle with mentally? How many of you agree? It's a mental thing. Yeah, you're right. How many of you say, well, it's a spiritual thing? You're right. Okay, how many would you say, it wraps up my emotions? How many would you agree that it just wraps up our emotions? Forgiveness, yeah, it reaches into all those areas. And here's the thing. Satan knows that the only area that can put you in bondage in body, mind, soul, and spirit is unforgiveness. It is the only thing that can cause bondage into multiple layers of you, and usually you're the last one to figure it out. Because there's so many things going on, and Peter says, listen, you've got to be sober-minded, you've got to be watchful, you've got to be alert, you've got to be careful, because the enemy is going about like this roaring lion. And then we see Jesus in the Gospels, in Matthew, and he's talking to them about this thing called forgiveness. Forgiveness is an easy thing to say, but it's a hard thing to do. How many of you have ever said, I'm sorry? Okay, it's good to say that. But how many of you have ever had a hard time accepting someone else's I'm sorry? You know why? Because pride in you makes you suspicious. I mean, that's just a fact of life. Study psychology. Study the origin of unforgiveness. Study the origin of mental anguish, and you will find that many things stem back to personal pride. But when we get hurt, it's almost like we put a cocoon on, and everything that touches the sensors that involves our pain, what do? We lash out. We lash out at family, we lash out at work, we lash out in community. If somebody, listen, how many maniac drivers do we have? I know you're not going to admit that. But when some, all right, well, don't ride with him. If you saw any other hand go up, don't get in the boat with them. But here's the thing. I have done it. Some time ago, a little over a year or so ago, when we lost our son, I jumped in the truck and I started driving. Bad idea. Because when I finally came to my senses, I was going about 90 miles an hour down 17. Okay? When you get hurt by anything in your life, it causes you to be erratic. It causes everything to just blur, and it's almost like we become robotic to where the things we do when we've been hurt, we don't even remember doing them. We don't remember saying them. We don't remember driving. How many of you have ever taken a drive and then go, wow, I just went over the James River Bridge and didn't even remember going across it? Yeah. Several of you have done that, okay? That's because there's something on the inside of us psychologically that is programmed almost robotically to certain surroundings, certain scenes, certain behaviors, and certain patterns. But Jesus tells them, Peter comes to him and he goes, hey, Lord, listen, this area of forgiveness, you know, how often do you want us to forgive? How often do you want us to forgive someone that sins against me, someone that does something against my family, someone that does something against my children, someone that does something against me, or what do we do? And he says, do you want us to forgive them, you know, seven times? And Peter's like, man, you know, I'm spiritual. Seven times. That's even a perfect number, Jesus. Don't he's smiling at Jesus? And Jesus says, no, I don't want you to forgive seven times, but I want you to forgive 70 times seven. How many math fanatics do we have? What's 70 times seven? Okay. It is a literal impossibility for someone to offend you 490 times a day. In an area of offense, it is impossible for someone to offend you. And this one 490 times, this one 490 times, there's no possible way. Do the math. It is not possible to take place in the course of a day. So what was Jesus telling? Was he saying, no, it's not possible to forgive? No, Jesus was saying, listen, I want you to understand forgiveness. Forgiveness is without limits. And when we're talking about living under the influence of forgiveness, I'm saying live under the influence of forgiveness without limits, without withholding forgiveness. And you see, here's the reason why. Forgiveness is not about the other person. Forgiveness is about us. Because we are the ones that are held into the contemptive bondage that seems to erode our soul and affects everything we see. I remember many years ago, and this was many, many years ago, throughout high school and everything, I didn't wear glasses. And I remember as we were approaching my senior year, my mom took me to get my eyes checked. And, you know, we'd get our eyes checked, and it's really easy to memorize the big line. You'd go to school and you'd memorize the line. Nobody thought your eyes were messed up. And so I always thought that this vision that I'm looking through right now was real. That this was the way it is. And here's the thing. Get your faces in now because you're all blurry. So, I mean, I can tell you there, but, you know, if you stick your tongue out or something, you know, I can't see it. Except for Green Bay fans. They have a distinct aura around them. That's for you right over there, sir. No. But I thought this was the norm. And especially if you cover the right eye, I mean, this is really insane. If you were to see what I'm seeing right now, wow, just everything's blurry. You look down the road and I would always have to move to the front of the classroom because I was unable to see clearly, and I would kind of squint and I would get my bearings and I could be able to function. And I remember sitting there at this doctor's office and realizing I'm not able to see properly. And they put this little thing on my nose, and they start turning the dials. Those of you that have glasses know what I'm talking about, or contact. Click, 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 click. And all of a sudden, as they're turning those dials, I went, he goes, yeah, you can see now. For years, I walked around thinking that this was the way I was supposed to view life, when this was the better picture. To compare that to hurt in our life, when we get hurt, it shakes up our system. When our family gets devastated, it shakes up our system in such a way that it distorts our perception. How many of you have ever spun around a whole bunch of times and then realized you can't keep doing that for an extended amount of time? Because your senses get overloaded and your perception begins to change as things around you are spinning. Question, are things around you spinning? No, but they appear to be because of what you went through. Many times in life, because of what we go through, and I know life hurts, and I know sometimes people stick their foot in their mouth, and I know sometimes the guy cuts you off at the light and didn't even ask for permission to jump in front of you, and I know you were rushing to get to Walmart, and it just frustrated you, and you wanted to, with road rage, reach out of your car with a go-go gadget arm and yank somebody out of the vehicle. I know that you've experienced those moments, but it's when those experiences hold on to you and you relive them in your mind to where you literally begin to create realities that did not happen. And so then, 2 years later, the guy that cut you off, this is the way the story unfolds. Yeah, this guy cut me off and he had a giant claw on the back of his car. He picked the road up and he moved it over here. Yeah, I saw that. He picked the road up. He picked the road up. You're kidding, man, that guy didn't. There's no way he picked the road. Yeah, I saw him pick the road up. You know, when you get hurt, your perception is off. I know this. I've walked it. I've had to struggle and strain through it. Not always got it right. But when we don't let God deal with the hurts on the inside of us, it distorts our perception. And instead of us being an instrument of God's grace and His mercy and His peace, we become an instrument in the hands of someone else, distorting the viewpoint of Christianity. Christianity is distorted today, not because the Bible isn't true, but because God's people allowed things to affect them that should have never affected them. You know, have you ever gone to a store and saw someone there and maybe they didn't recognize your presence? And you walk around Walmart the whole time going, gosh, you know, I saw them over there on my aisle and they just didn't talk to me today. They don't like me. They don't like me. Something's wrong with them. They don't like me. They've got a problem. What are they? They're hiding something. They don't want me to see them. They don't like me. They don't like my family. They don't like my car. They don't like my basket. They don't like my purse. Not my purse. I don't carry a purse, but they don't like my hair. Let me get off the purse part. Okay, so they don't like all this stuff. And then you hear a story from them that says, Millie didn't like me. She saw me in the grocery store and she didn't come up to me. I'm telling you, we get bent out of shape from stuff that distorts us, that God wants us to learn to live under the influence of forgiveness. That it's not something, you know, will you forgive me? Yeah, I'll think about it. Forgiveness, what would we do is if when we sinned and said, Lord, forgive us, God said, you know what, let me think about that. If God said, let me think for a few days on whether I'll get back to you with my answer. Forgiveness is not about the other person. Forgiveness is about you. Because unforgiveness in the heart of a believer will cause your soul to erode, and it will literally transform you into a bitter soul. To where you'll get older, and every time you walk in the earth and things happen, there's just this negative mindset, and you walk around like this. Look up here, please. Ready? You love Jesus? Yes, I love Jesus! I'm a believer, can't you tell? I'll punch you in the face. Yeah. Number one, if you act like that, you've got a problem. Sir, ma'am. And most of the time, if left unchecked, that's what believers become. And so their life progresses, they get older, and then we hear people say things like this. That's a bitter, old individual. They still go to church. They still praise the Lord. But everything about them is negative. You sit down to eat dinner. The roll's cold. The fork's bent. The plate's chipped. The pecan or pecan, however you say it. You said it wrong. You know? Steak's not done enough. Steak's too done. Barbecue's dry. Barbecue's too moist. Chocolate cake. I hate chocolate cake. And I would submit to you that those are symptoms of a much deeper problem. If all someone around you does is gripe, grumble, and complain, it means there's an issue of bitterness in the soul. I guarantee it. I would stake my life on it that I could pinpoint a time in their life of something they've not let go, and it's poisoned them, even though they'll sit there and tell you, oh, I let that go years ago. Most of the time, that's our talking point. We say that, but we really haven't, because we want to try to avoid perceived judgment from someone else. And what we've done is psychologically tried to avoid that hurt reappearing, so we lie about things to people who ask us about them. And I know that's hard to swallow. But we do. And again, that's that protective thing that says, don't you let anybody get close, because the close ones are the ones that hurt you. But yet, that's the very thing Jesus calls us to, is to an embrace of one another in the kingdom of God. Be sober. Don't let anything impair your judgment. Don't let hurt impair your judgment. Do you realize that you can take clips out of your life and make an alternate reality? Do you know the media does that all the time? They will take one statement, one speech, and they will clip different parts of it together to mean something else. And then they say, no, I heard them say it. They said it on the news. I heard them say it on the news. I heard the voice. And it's clipped. We can do that with our memory. We can do that with our family. We can do that in society. We can do that in relationships. And if we're not careful, we start to have bitterness rise up in us because we fail to truly forgive. Forgiving someone does not mean you forget. No one in this room can erase their memory. Nobody can do that. But when you forgive, you stop holding someone in the jail cell of your mind, and that person that was being held hostage wasn't the other person, it was you. The Bible says, Jesus said, therefore the kingdom of heaven can be compared to, and when he says this, he's saying, pay attention, this is the kingdom of heaven. He says, there's a certain king, he decided to bring his accounts up to date with his servants who had borrowed money from him. And in the process, one of the debtors, that he came back owing him millions and millions of dollars, and he couldn't pay. So his master ordered him to be sold to pay the debt, but the man fell down at the feet of the master, and he begged him. He said, please don't sell me. Please don't sell my family. I'll pay you in full. Now, here's what you've got to understand about this debt. This man, if you were to equate it into an understandable number today, this servant owed the king 160,000 years of wages. You thought I was going to say dollars. 160,000 years of wages. How many of you would agree that's a lot of money? Okay? That's a lot. And this guy gets forgiven, and you would think that this guy would be so elated by the forgiveness. The Bible says that he goes out on the street and he finds a guy that owes him one day's labor, wages. And he goes to the guy and he grabs him by the throat and he says, you pay me everything. And he has the guy arrested. And the Bible says that when the king hears that the servant that was forgiven 160 plus thousand days, 160,000 years of wages, when he heard that he put the other guy in prison for one day's wages, calls him back to his throne room. And he says, you wicked servant, I forgave you all these things, but you failed to forgive. And the Bible says that he and his family were given over to the tormentors until all was repaid. Question for you, is it possible for them to have repaid the debt? No. That's why Jesus said, and the kingdom of heaven will be like this, that you will be tested with unforgiveness. And if you fail the test, it can put you in bondage, not just for a moment, not just for a second, but it can lead to an eternal bondage because it will create in you a debt you cannot pay. And oftentimes, it's easier to hold a grudge because it's something that's fun to talk about. I'll test the theory. How many of you have ever been to a restaurant? That's not a trick one. You've been to a restaurant, okay? But how many of you had a great experience at a restaurant? Okay? How many of you have ever had an absolute horrible experience at a restaurant? Okay? Why were there more hands that just responded to that one than the good? Because our sensors are programmed by the things that we experience to always identify the negative experiences first and then compare everything to them. Okay? And then our perception changes how we process things, okay? I'll test you on it. Who wants to be a guinea pig this morning? Okay, Derek, stand up. No, stand up. All right, here's my question for you, Derek. You have 30 cows in a field. Calm down. Hit that mute button, okay? You got 30 cows in a field. 28 chickens. How many did not?
30 cows, 28 chickens.
Yep, you got 30 cows, 28 chickens. How many did not?
Two.
Let me say it again. You have 30 cows in your field, 28 chickens. How many did not?
Two.
Let me say it a little bit different. You have 30 cows in a field, 28 chickens. How many did not? Yes, sir. Okay, what? Thank you, sir. You can sit down. Give him a hand. How many of you are like, wow, that was crazy? Anybody agree? Wow, what a crazy illustration. You know what happens to us? We get preconceived to how we hear things. Hurt can distort everything you see and everything you hear to where you can stand there and go, that doesn't make sense! When the whole time it made perfect sense, you just processed it wrong. Hurt will do that to you. Pain will do that to you. Especially when you experience a severe loss in a family unit, that kind of thing can happen to where everything is distorted. The danger of it, though, is not, you know, if you want to have a mean demeanor, you know, God bless you. I don't recommend it because I think people that walk around like that ought to be shaken. See, Nick, I didn't say anything that you told me not to say from the first service. You should be proud. He instructed me, he goes, if you don't mind, don't make that statement again. Because we'll have to edit it out. I know, now everybody's wondering what statement, Nick. See what you did to me? It's your fault. You hurt my soul before church, and now I've just wrecked everything because of you. No, I'm kidding. So, but you got to understand, I'm not trying to promote you and get you to walk around all the time on cloud nine with a big grin on your face. That's not my intent. My intent is to tell you, don't forfeit eternity because of bitterness of things that you failed to forgive. And they caused a breach in your soul. And you get placed in bondage. I'm telling you, everybody screams the grace of God. But Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is going to be just like this. And if Satan has been doing things for over 6,000 years, deceiving and entrenching people in bitterness and hurt and pain and difficulty, I think he's gotten pretty good at it. So what we have to do is sober up. We have to sober ourselves up. We have to wake up. I'll be done in just a second. So I decided, okay, let me look at what does it take to sober up? And some of you may have experienced this physically. So what are the six steps to sober up physically if you inebriate thyself? Well, the first thing they say is stop drinking. I mean, that's pretty novel, isn't it? I mean, just kind of cut and dry. Stop drinking, okay? How does that apply to unforgiveness? Well, stop ingesting all that negative stuff of everything you see. You've got to somehow at some point say, I'm not going to think that anymore because it's wrong. And instead of just saying, I'm not going to think that anymore because it's wrong and then pick it up tomorrow, I mean, I've got to stop thinking about it because it's wrong, period, and I don't need to pick it back up because it's putting me in bondage. The second thing they said is eat something. It's pretty interesting. So if someone's drunk, get them to eat something. If they're not sobered up, get them to eat something. God has given to you and I His Word. The Word of God is like fresh bread, and the Bible tells us that we are to eat the bread of life. This right here is our sustenance. So if we will stop allowing the junk to filter in our mind and consume the Word, chances are we will have a good chance at sobering up. Number three, they said, drink water. Drink water. I mean, this is simple stuff. What does that mean? Ask for the Spirit of God to be poured into your life. It's a physical principle, I know, but I believe it's spiritual for us. How do you avoid unforgiveness, Lord? Pour your Spirit in my life and in my heart and enable me to step out of the confines of the pain that led to fear, that led to a burden, that led to bondage, that led to unforgiveness, that led to bitterness. Enable me by your Spirit. And the fourth thing they said was introduce caffeine. How many coffee drinkers do we have in the house? I love coffee. How many people have a Keurig machine? Okay, awesome. How many of you know how to work on them? Mine's broke. I tried. I would have never put it up here had I not checked that one off the list first. I don't know. It's pumping, and it sounds like... I'm going to be honest with you, and this is going to seem really... It sounds like the Keurig machine has diarrhea. and I'm not going to drink that coffee, number one. But number two, it's barely coming out, so I don't know what's going on. I'm not doing it. So if somebody has an answer for it, let me know, because I'm about to take it and shot put it in the parking lot, okay? So, hallelujah. Pastor, have you filtered it out? Yes. Have you put cleaner through it? Yes. Have you? I've done everything but beat it with a golf club, and I've come real close to that in the last couple days. Just practicing a swing on it. Four. But the fourth thing they say is introduce caffeine. Introduce a stimulant to your system. Do you realize that when we worship God, the Spirit of God stimulates our senses? We don't just come into church to sing a song just because it's the right thing to do. We know that corporate worship and individual worship stimulates the impulses in the mind, the body, and the soul. And the Spirit of God engages us and ignites us in a time of worship. We've got to have that in order to be sober. Number five, take a cold shower. You say, huh. How are you going to relate that one, buddy? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because a cold shower not only wakes you up, but it also will clean you. And the Bible says that we are to be washed by the water of the Word of God. In other words, we have to ask God through His Word in partnership with His Spirit to clean us up. That's the way sobering up works. And when it comes to unforgiveness, we have to ask God to wash all those things out of us that cause that disconnect. And the sixth thing was just rest. Rest in the Lord. Rest in Him, leaving all that poisonous stuff behind. And it's really, to me, a simple thing is saying to God and really living it out, God, You do a work in me that I'm not able to do myself. Yes, I got hurt. Yes, I got disappointed. Yes, I was devastated. Yes, I took a hit. Yes, I took a loss. But I'm asking You, would You come and open up our eyes? Would You come and make sure the lenses of my soul are proper, lest I fall and become a stumbling block to others? Forgiveness is a progressive and an instantaneous work. And you will always be tested in this area. Forgiveness will always require different lenses. And I'll close with this thought. But if you get up in the morning and you put on the wrong lenses, do you realize that you can run over people? You can run over your family. And this is something that we all get tested on. There's no one above trial. There's no one above testing. The enemy wants to destroy every single person sitting in here, especially now that you've heard what I've told you today. And here's what I know. Once an information in the kingdom of God is given, we are always tested to see if we retained it. I'm not saying you're going to walk out of this door. I know you might get in the bake auction and somebody outbid you. You might run out of here and post on Facebook, they all hate me at Healing Waters. I didn't get my chocolate cake. And then do the nah look on your face and take a selfie of it. Please don't do that. Listen. He's been doing this for thousands and thousands of years. Forgiveness will not change the past. It's impossible. Can't change the past, but it can prevent you from bringing about the past again in your future if you learn to let it go. But you don't know what they did. I know. There's certain things in my story that you don't know what was done. But here's what I know. The forgiveness was never about them. It was always about me. Because it vexed my soul. And if you don't get rid of it, it will destroy you from the inside out. In 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now, you'll look back on the journey that is charted out behind you and you'll say, I regret this, I regret, I regret, I regret, I regret, I regret. I'm telling you, unforgiveness will destroy you from the inside out. God wants you to live under the influence of forgiveness. Peter said, be sober, be watchful, be mindful, because the enemy, he's looking for you. And if he sees weakness, he's going to exploit it. But I guess he hadn't figured it out yet that Christ in us is greater than anything around us that could ever come to us if we'll submit ourselves to Christ. I want you to stand with me today. Maybe you're here today and there's somebody you need to forgive. Maybe there's something you've been walking around carrying. Man, it's a heavy, heavy load. In just a moment, we're going to pray. And then as we kind of wrap that up and transition into their time that they have the bake auction, we're going to have people up front here that after we pray, if you say, you know what, man, I'm tired carrying this burden. I'm tired. Every time I turn around, the same pain pops right back up. The same hurt pops right back up. Every time somebody else does something not even related to what I got hurt in, it just keeps popping back up. I can tell you why it keeps popping back up, because forgiveness really hasn't been offered. And sometimes that's hard to hear. But I want you to know there'll be people in this altar that will pray with you, that will listen to you, and I promise you, they will not take what you tell them out of this room. If they do, they will no longer be in the room. That's how much we value what you go through. Okay? But I know it's hard. So I want us to pray and ask God to help us with whatever it is that we're carrying. And if something's come up to the surface in your heart today, then as soon as we're done praying, I want you to come find someone to pray with you. And if we've got more folks that respond, that we got plenty of leaders and staff, we want to make sure that someone touches and agrees with you in prayer today. But unforgiveness will destroy your soul, and you will be the last one to know about it. Father, thank you for your word today. You desire us to walk and live under the influence of forgiveness. You want us to sober up and to be watchful, be mindful. And Lord, the way that looks in this particular area is we've got to wake up, sober up, and be mindful in the area of forgiveness. We've all been hurt at different times. We've all been devastated. Pain has come. Difficulties come. Yes, there were moments we wanted to run away. There were moments we wanted to change our name and flee the country. But here we are, with all of our stuff. Help our area of forgiveness. And help us to understand that forgiveness doesn't do anything else for the other person that hurt us. It sets us free. And so, Lord, today, if there's deep-seated hurt, deep-seated distractions, whatever's come, I pray that you would bring closure and healing and help in time of need. Help us to live under the influence of forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you today. Listen, if you want prayer, there's folks up here. Come and let them pray. They're not going to hold you hostage here. They're not going to, be crazy with you, but they will pray with you. And then we'll be joined together. Hopefully you can stay for the time of bake auction. It's a lot of fun. But God bless you. We love you. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.